guys, I'm excited about this show today. We are live coming to you from Marietta, from our studio. And as a lot of you guys know, I speak on leadership through motivation, inspiration, and perspiration. And we have live and in color, Lori, who I just met, but she's a graduate of the John Maxwell School. And John is, and Lori said it was okay for me to say this, he is the grandfather, the godfather of leadership and speaking. That's been his forte, his whole really title, right, for years. So I'm excited to learn myself so much that Lori's gonna be able to share with us today because of the leadership title. But before we do that, Lori, we can't let you go until we learn who you are, where it all started, where you're at today, and then where you see yourself going.
Just love it.
So we have some people that we know in common from the industry, right? So I'm really looking forward to learning much more about you and some of the things that you do, what you're doing now, and the value that you're bringing, because I know that we're going to be able to collaborate afterwards. So I'm excited. So. Lori, where did it all start?
Well, I was born and raised in the San Diego area.
Okay, all right, spoiled.
Yeah.
We call that spoiled from the East Coast.
I was spoiled.
This is paradise.
You know, it is. No, it is. And I really don't know anything else. I've only lived in Southern California. And I have lived in a few places that weren't that great in Southern California.
Sure.
But every place I've lived, I believe I've taken some wonderful things from those areas and learned and grown, and they've all been valuable. So my folks, my dad was an executive with a corporation in the San Diego area.
Okay.
He started ground floor and worked his way up. So he was my role model. Mm. And he had a very unbelievable work ethic. He had a high level of integrity. People saw value in him, and he was a leader as well.
Wow.
My mom was a stay-at-home mom.
Okay.
And so her job was to keep the house clean, to have that white glove house, to make sure my brother and I had everything we needed. And in so many ways, it was a really ideal childhood.
Like a real traditional,
traditional
household, really. Right?
Very traditional in my time of growing up.
Sure.
Not so much.
That's true. Good point. Yes.
Absolutely.
Very untraditional right now, right, for the last, I'd say 25 years, right?
Right.
Yeah, because of the two incomes and all that. Yeah.
Right.
Yep.
So I felt like I grew up really quite privileged. But at the same time, you know, every family has its dysfunction.
Yeah.
And in my family, my mom suffered from some depression. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't just some depression.
It was pretty intense.
It could be really intense at times.
Mm-hmm.
And that affected me.
You know, and let me just, because what I love to do is kind of pull out those golden nuggets, right?
Sure.
In your story. Because a lot of times, as you know, it's hard to see the picture inside the frame, right?
It is.
So I wanna pull you out of that frame a little
bit.
You
got it.
So, you know,
pull me.
Atta girl. So, you know, a lot of people, and I want to touch on this because a lot of people are under the misconception that it's only them. Right, and when they look and they see that, and I'm going to use this because there's nothing else I can think of is that white picket fence does not necessarily mean that it's the white picket fence behind that white picket fence, if you know what I mean.
I think
your story is really going to help people. The hardest thing I have to get people on this show is because they're running from their story.
Right,
they're afraid to share their story because it maps to that big bully, that fear barrier, that you're worried about what other people think and how they're going to judge you, right?
Absolutely.
And so I want, this is a great thing, because it's not like, you know, you're saying you're coming from the inner city and you were struggling to eat, and we had those stories as well, right? Awesome.
Absolutely.
Awesome stuff.
Yes.
But this is such a different dynamic that's going to relate to a lot of people. So you were that white picket fence, right? So from the outside, it looked like she's
perfect.
Not at all.
Perfect.
She's got it all. And you even mentioned, you even referenced that. You said you were you felt privileged, right?
I did.
But so I just wanted to kind of highlight that. Yeah. Everyone has every family and every person has their issues, right?
Oh yeah.
And it's whether or not you can address them and manage them, or you let them manage you, right? So I just wanted to. This is going to be really good. I like this. So you had from the outside, it looked like everything in order.
Right.
But the real is, not everything was in order.
It wasn't in order.
Love it. I love it.
And the thing of it is I tell people my story because I want them to know just that.
Mm-hmm.
That although sometimes things look really wonderful from the outside looking in, if you were a bug on the wall in that home, it might not have been everything that you thought it was going to be.
And it's still okay.
It is.
That's the thing.
It's still okay.
That is, that actually is so interesting, right?
Yeah.
So many people in your, it would be in your position, would look at it as, and I want your feedback on this, right?
Yeah.
Would be, it's dysfunction, right? It's not normal. But it actually is normal. It's the norm.
Oh, absolutely.
We all have our things. We all have, and that's just called life. So I love that. I love how this is going to really connect. I love this story.
Well, the wonderful thing about it is that, you know, everyone has a story, and no matter what your story is, there's things that we overcome and things that we learn about our life, especially if we're able to call it truth. I'm a truth seeker.
Mm.
And for years, if you had asked me about my family, I would have said, heck yeah, we were perfect. You know, we were the perfect family. We had the perfect home and the perfect neighborhood, and my dad worked hard and gave a great example. My mom worked hard in our home, making everything perfect, and I would have left it right there.
Yep.
Because I believed that.
Right.
And that was my story until I got old enough to realize what impact the things that happened in our home had on me.
So that's what we want to, that's where the real value comes in. That's the real. So my question, kind of twofold, right?
Mm-hmm.
How did it affect you as a little girl growing up and where you're at today? And also, what did you learn from it now that you can look back, right?
Yeah.
All the years back. So so share that with us. That's awesome.
Yeah. Well, I think the first thing that I realized about my journey was when I was in school, my brother is a little older than me, a very intelligent person. Highly intelligent, I would say. He skipped a grade and everyone loved him. He has that personality that you're immediately drawn to because he is just the perfect person to me. And to many people, I think. He is my best cheerleader and my support. And I just adore him. But growing up and being second after him was really hard for a couple of reasons, because the expectation was really high and I came in and I had some learning trouble. And so I hit first grade and all of a sudden things were really hard.
Wow.
I didn't understand what was wrong with me, because back in those days they didn't have identified learning difficulties.
Yeah.
And so in first grade, I had a hard time spelling. I saw everything backwards, and if I went to the board to write my spelling words, they were all messed up. And the kids laughed at me. I can distinctly remember going to the board, and I was supposed to write the word girl, and it came out grill. And so for the longest time, all the kids say, hey, Grill, how are you? And they teased mercifully. And I made jokes about it because that was my coping mechanism.
But it still hurt. Yeah,
it hurt. And then my teacher wrote on my report card, she wrote, I'm not living up to her potential. And I think part of that was because I had this older brother, and part of it was me. I take responsibility because I really just didn't get it. I had a hard time.
Was that first grade?
Yes.
Well, and look, we're all about taking responsibility, right? But listen, first grade, there's got to be something put on the teacher and the learning system, because and also. also, we understand the time that it was different too, because I had my struggles as well.
Yeah.
You know, short attention span, and you know, just want to be outside doing things that were physical, and I hate being in that classroom. Mm-hmm. You know, I still have trouble in my office. I still have trouble in my office.
So now,
as you started to get, you know, second, third, fourth, fifth grade, how was it?
I had it figured out by third grade.
You did?
I did. I was like, got it together.
How did you do that?
I don't know. I just learned that...
Because we're talking about dyslexia, right? I would imagine.
I believe I did have dyslexia. Okay. Both of my daughters had something called dysgraphia, which is similar to dyslexia, but you see things differently, basically. Oh. And you have to learn some coping skills to learn. And somehow, on my own, I learned those coping skills. And by third grade, I had it down and I was ready to go.
Wow.
You know, to tell you the truth, I really think my brother helped me a lot. Because all through school, because he was ahead of me, and because he explained things in a way I understood,
right.
I really think that that was part of my learning.
He was able to explain things for you to be able to pick it up.
Right.
Versus a teacher.
Right.
Wow.
Well, the teachers weren't trained.
But either was he.
No, that's true. That's
right?
The point. But he was the really smart guy.
But yeah, that's interesting.
It is.
Did that help you now with your daughters?
It did, because the thing that I learned having my own children was no matter what our gifts are or what they aren't, is that we as people have to really view ourselves as unique. And I'm a woman of faith, so I really believe that God has made us each perfect.
Mm-hmm.
I do believe that our journey is different and that we have things to learn along the way. And for them, I tried to just help them know that no matter what they did in school, no matter what life challenges gave them, that it was okay, we would work it out. And that was the message I tried to give early on.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I don't know that I was a perfect parent.
Well, of course not.
But I had a perfect desire to be a perfect parent.
Yeah, I mean, you're human. I mean, so there's no one, you know, gave you an actual book and said, how do you do this? So, but at the end of the day, you know, because I live my life with intention, right? So if my intention is pure, and I do something or say something that offends you, I'm okay with that. My head's on the pillow. Maybe you need to figure out why that word offends you so much that you're going to actually stop learning. So your intent is the bottom line.
Yeah.
Is your intention was there. Your intention was pure.
Mm-hmm.
And you obviously, I can tell by who you are, and it takes me 2 seconds, that you gave it everything you got, right?
I did.
You gave it everything you had. And that's all you can do.
Yeah.
And I love the fact that you focus more on the... understanding who they were versus keeping them in a lane.
Right.
And I was a little, I benefited a little bit from that as well from my mom, because she didn't buy into the teachers and the school system telling them that, you know, he has a learning disability, there's something wrong, we're trying to, and she just wouldn't buy it, you know? And she always supported me. So that's interesting, that I love that you went more for the self-image than you did the image.
Mm-hmm.
Does that make sense?
I do.
Yeah.
It does make sense. And looking back, you know, you always kind of think of what would I have done different, you know, because
you have
to reflect in order to be a better person in the future. And there were things that I picked up looking back that I would have done differently with my girls, but I did the best I could. So that was one struggle that I was having in my early years.
Mm-hmm.
The other one was my mom.
Mm-hmm.
And my mom's mental illness really affected me.
In what way?
And I'll tell you, and you touched on it a little bit too. Somewhere in my early years, my parents had a family that they knew, and the mom had committed suicide.
Okay.
And in my own home, I remember the word depression coming up.
Mm.
And so I associated depression with the lady that had committed suicide.
Yeah, with death, right?
And from very early on, I worried that something might happen to my mom.
You were constantly on eggshells.
Constantly. I was.
That's a rough way to live, especially for a little girl.
It was awful. It was awful when I look back, because that fear really took hold of me.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember very, very frequently, especially like in the fifth and sixth grade, and I don't remember where I heard about this lady, but I just put two and two together and worried about my mom. And so when my brother went away to college, I was in the sixth grade, and my mom grieved my brother being gone. She went through a grief process that was...
A mourning.
It was.
Will. I mean, yeah.
I would get home from school, and she would be sitting on my brother's bed holding one of his shirts and crying, and I didn't know which end was up, and I didn't understand that at all. And so I worried something would happen. And so when other kids were, you know, kind of thinking, oh, what kind of snack are we going to have when we get home? In the back of my mind was, I hope my mom's okay. And if I hit that front door and she didn't say, I'm back here, I'm whatever, holy moly, I went through all kinds of stress.
So it was just, it was just anxious, anxiety, you know, worry, stress. Like you said, how did your dad handle that?
Well, you know, my dad worked really long hours. And you know, I don't think he fully grasped everything that was going on, but he wanted her to get help.
Or he did, and that was his way of, you know, who knows, but yeah, you just never know. I just was curious as how he handled it. So he kind of knew, maybe didn't know, or knew and handled it his own way, you know?
I'm sure he knew to a degree because my mom was going to doctors and she had been put on medication and a lot of different things. So he knew. But he was trying to support the family and trying to support her. And my dad adored my mom. When my mom passed away, they were still happily married, and he took care of her in a beautiful way. He always said, she took care of me all those years I worked, so now it's time for me to take care of her.
And good man.
He was a saint.
Good
he really
man.
Was.
Good.
We joke about it, that he was a beautiful human being.
What a good man. So now when you're in high school, and are you still feeling that anxiousness? Are you still feeling that what is going to, you know, what am I going to find when I get home?
Yeah, I did. But it wasn't quite as powerful as when I was younger.
Okay.
I think I had come to terms that, well, nothing's happened yet. You know, she's getting help.
And you're getting older.
I'm getting older. I definitely, it tickled the back of my mind very frequently.
Yeah.
Even after I moved away from home, I wondered how she would be, because she had had a few pretty significant episodes of having a hard time. And what was a beautiful thing with her is, because I hate to leave people hanging like that, because she did get the help she needed, and it was through her faith. And if she was sitting right here, she would tell you that she was healed by God.
Okay.
She went to a women's event, and somehow it changed her.
Wow.
And it was dramatic.
Was it like a weekend thing?
Yeah, it was.
Wow.
It was, and I don't even know exactly what it was. Something in my mind tells me it was a day of prayer. And I can't sit here and tell you it was perfect. You know, after that.
Sure.
But what I can tell you is she had so much more joy after that, and happiness, you know, and she was, it was just a joy for her.
And you know, I'd love to touch on that too, because you know, obviously I don't know much about it. I only know what you're sharing right here, but it's pretty blatant that whatever created that paradigm shift.
Right.
And that's it.
That's all it is.
That's all it was a paradigm shift.
Yeah, you're absolutely
right. So interesting that that's all it is.
I know.
It's a shift. It's perspective.
Yes.
It's perception.
It
and
is.
It's so cool. That's what I love about the mind.
Yes.
Right? It's so interesting that, you know, 2 weeks before that, 2 days before that, 24 hours before that moment, she was a different person.
I mean,
think about that. It's a paradigm.
One little tweak.
Right.
Or
the other interesting thing, it could have been multiple things building up to, but either way, she left one person and came home another. I mean, I just love the mind and how it works in the conscious, subconscious, and I know that's right up your alley.
So
after that weekend, did it get easier on you?
Yeah.
Okay.
The dynamics changed. In fact, it's really funny because part of my story is, as a little girl, I didn't always feel loved by my mom. Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
I know
I'm sure.
She loved me.
No, but there was, because she had issues with herself.
Yeah.
So she can't give what
exactly.
she doesn't have,
exactly.
or she, or I should say, what she believes she doesn't have.
Right.
Right? I mean, that's
exactly.
that's more accurate.
She was trying so
yeah.
hard to have the perfect household
mm-hmm.
And have all this pressure. Her husband was promoting
mm-hmm.
and more was expected of her
mm-hmm.
and she was having a hard time keeping up, and she thought she was missing something. And so, just like you said, if you don't have it to give, you can't give it. And I think my brother was the easy kid, and I was not the easy kid.
I have a question. I'm curious.
Yeah,
it just
yeah.
came to me.
Mm-hmm. I love that. Intuition.
And that's what we do here. It's just real
it
raw and live.
I like it.
I got a question, though. Do you think that your mom's part of that issue she had anything to do with not feeling like her purpose was big enough, even though it was her family? Like, in other words, do you think that she was missing something? Do you think that she, you know, again, maybe her own business, maybe some, like, do you think that was missing? Do you think there was something, do you think that could have been a void?
I think there was a void in her life.
For sure, because
mm-hmm.
because of the of you know what she put herself through, right?
Right.
I'm just curious, like I wonder if it's just she needed more, but didn't understand that she needed more or couldn't identify that she needed
mm-hmm.
more. You think that could
yeah.
be? You do?
I do. Because her own childhood was very traumatic.
Oh.
And
okay.
She wasn't raised in a family of privilege by any stretch of the
right,
imagination.
Right.
And her mom died when she was very young.
Okay.
Her dad really suffered in that loss.
Yeah.
And then married a lady that was not kind to my mom or to her brothers. And my
right.
mom was the youngest child.
Mm.
And I think my mom had a lot of things from her childhood that she had not reconciled.
Mm.
And
that makes sense.
Yeah.
yeah. That makes
Sorry.
Sense.
It, yeah, and it does make sense. And knowing people more now,
yeah.
I realize how difficult it must have been for my mom.
Mm.
And the beauty of it is my mom was almost a day and night different person, like we talked about.
Mm.
But after that, I think she knew that she had a hard time with me growing up.
Mm.
And from that point forward, every time I was with my mom, she would always make sure to really pour love on me.
And wow.
Yeah, even when I would leave, every time, she'd cup her hands on my face and say, honey, I'm so proud of you.
Wow.
I love you so much.
Wow, what
and
a gift.
It was. To this day,
wow.
I think the thing that I remember and loved about her so much is what she did with her life that changed after that.
And talk about, I mean, that's the true definition of courage.
Yeah.
Right? Because there was so much fear and probably now that you shared even more because it was that trickle down effect of her childhood, right? Where
right.
she was probably afraid to show that or didn't know
yeah.
how to show that. Man, that is some weekend. I'd love to know what that weekend was.
I know,
that
me
is,
too.
That is some
me
weekend.
Too.
That's a life changer, right? That's
was.
I did a show last night called The Game Changer. That's
oh,
the Game Changer
it
weekend.
Was.
That is wild.
It was.
It's so interesting how that works. So now you're out of high school. Did you go to college?
No.
Okay.
I went into a fashion school.
Okay.
I wanted to be in fashion merchandising.
Okay.
I dabbled a little bit with modeling.
Okay.
I started working for a Bullock's department store after that,
mm-hmm.
and I was in their management program, and I really loved all of that.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, like I know, some things just aren't your passion,
mm-hmm.
and I thought it was my passion. I was moving towards that. I liked the idea.
But there was something missing. Huh?
Yeah, it wasn't the right career path for me, and so. I did a lot of different things, and of course I, you know, became a young woman, I married, I
sure.
had my
kids.
Girls,
mm-hmm.
my husband and I owned a business together, and...
Oh, wow.
I have a, you know, so
wow.
I have a business background
yeah.
as well. I know what it's like to make a business work, and I know what it takes to make one fail, and fortunately we didn't make ours fail, but we were able to sell it at a time that worked out really good for us.
Okay. What business?
It was a car repair business.
Okay.
So we did mechanical repairs.
So you worked, was that your full-time thing?
Yeah.
So you guys worked it together?
We did.
Okay.
My husband was the brain to fix cars.
Okay.
And I was the brain on the business side.
Beautiful.
Yeah, we worked really good as a team. But as a marriage, it was hard.
Mm.
Because when you're self-employed with your spouse and you're together 24/7, any of the flaws in the marriage really get highlighted.
Mm.
And unfortunately, as you may or may not know, very frequently people feel safe in certain surroundings. And for me, with him, unbeknownst to me, he had a lot of mental issues also, like my mom.
Wow.
So he suffered from depression, and there were times where he couldn't go to work, and times he wasn't functional.
Wow. And you were familiar with that. I mean,
very
now
familiar.
It came back, right?
It came back.
So let me ask you this. How did that affect you? Because that had to be like, wow, this is like
awful.
Deja vu, big time. And not only deja vu, but a business at stake, you know, your livelihood at stake.
Right.
So how were you able to handle it?
Well, I continued to run the business and we have techs working for us.
Okay.
So
you could limp through. And,
we did limp through,
yeah.
In fact.
Yeah.
I think for me, the more dramatic part was the effect on my girls.
Oh.
I wanted them to think that everything was normal, life is good.
Daddy's
still kind of not doing too well, but that's okay, you know, we'll get over it.
right. No, and it's natural, you know, you want to do that. So, so how did you obviously they know, right, mm-hmm. because they're little girls.
Yeah.
How did that affect them?
You know, I don't know how it affected my younger daughter because she passed away when she was 16.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it was tough. That was a very tough time. With my older daughter, who is now in her late 30s, if you will, she'll have a birthday next month. The perfect mom in me would like to say didn't affect her at all, and yet I know it did.
Yeah, I'm sure.
And we've talked about it. You know, her dad has not been a great influence on her.
Mm-hmm.
And he hasn't provided her a loving, nurturing father relationship like mm-hmm. we would hope he would. And their relationship is very disjointed.
Mm-hmm.
And I think my job was try to make up for it.
Yeah.
And so even still, I can't be with them 24/7. But when I am with them, I just want to show them what love looks like and what nurturing looks like and, you know, to try to help them be the best they can be. My granddaughters is what I'm speaking of. And my daughter, you know, she does have some areas of her life, I think, that it affects her.
Mm-hmm.
But she's a lot like me in that, you know what? That is what it is. Let's
figure this out.
Yeah.
And keep moving forward.
Keep moving.
And that's the ultimate, you know, that's the ultimate character test. That, you know, life always gives us tests, and they want to know how bad do you want it, and what are you made of, you know?
Right.
So I call it the life boot camps.
It just
happens, but you can't build that character until you can get through that, right?
Right.
So I love that. So before we move forward, Marion, I saw we had some people jump on. Thank you for jumping on. Thanks for taking the time.
And Kelly Blair says, how exciting to turn into MMTV and see two clients, both of whom are becoming my friends. Lord, thanks, Dave. Thanks, Lord.
Awesome, awesome. She's awesome. She's getting my office squared away.
She's doing me too.
Yes, it's just
I'm
great.
So
it's perfect. It's perfect. And she actually picked up a few clients from Monster Motivator TV. So we're excited. That's what we're all about. We want to connect.
Yeah.
Anybody else, Mary?
Greg Walker says, "What's up, bro?" He shared it.
Big Greg. Thank you, man. Thank you for sharing. Thank you for showing the love, guys. Share the episode if you're connecting, if you feel that value, and we still got a lot to go. Thanks for the love. Thanks for the hearts. Anybody else, Marion?
We have a shout out from Anthony O'Connor.
Anthony, thank you so much. Thank you for taking the time.
And shout out from Carrie Stonebridge.
All right, Carrie, always count on her. Thank you so much.
Joseph Rothman.
All right. Big Joe, man. I hope everything's well. Thanks for jumping on. And And we're going to, the next next part of this, I want to talk about your transition and how you met John Maxwell, and give us a little overview on who he is for anybody out there that doesn't know. Anybody else, Marion?
Yeah, we have Eunice Torres.
Okay, thank you, Eunice. And you're going to be able to, once we get off, right, I'm going to reshare this. And I know we're connected on Facebook, so now you're going to be able to reconnect with everyone.
How fun.
Post all your information and connect with them.
Yeah, that'd be great.
Who else? Anybody else, Marion? Awesome, awesome, man. Gloria, thank you so much. I know that you, with your promo, did you see your promo?
No.
Oh, I attached you on it. So on your Facebook, you can, that's right. You can resend it, but Gloria says she knows you.
Yeah.
Okay, and obviously Cindy's the one that connected us.
Yeah.
So guys, thank you so much for jumping on. If get a chance, please share this, and don't be afraid to show some hearts. So... the grandfather of leadership. how did that even come about? Because you were telling me that he was a pastor, which I had no idea.
Yeah.
Right? And he was your pastor.
He was.
So when did you actually meet John for the first time?
I met John in the mid-80s.
Okay.
He had come to San Diego to be our head pastor at a church, Skyline Wesleyan Church. If you have read any of his books, he references that time in his life.
He does? Okay.
Mm-hmm. And that was the time I shared with him. My parents started going to the church shortly after he got there. I mean, I think right away we all knew he was very unique.
Okay.
And that he was going to be wonderful.
Okay.
And so I want to say within a few months, we decided to go, my family, and I never left. I mean, I just was mesmerized by his message, by his intelligence.
His energy,
yeah. His caring, and his humor, too. A lot of people don't realize just how funny he is.
Yeah.
And he loves a good time.
Yeah?
Yeah, and he made the church that way.
Wow.
And really helped all of us learn about attitude was the first thing I really learned from him. And one of his books was Your Attitude Determines Your Altitude.
Yes.
And I used to have that as a screensaver on my computer for years, because I really truly believe that if we have a positive attitude, we can overcome anything.
It's such a big part of the whole recipe, I call it.
It is.
Absolutely. It's a huge, huge part of the recipe. So let me ask you this. Looking back now, whether you could identify it then or not, but looking back now, when he was your pastor and he would do his sermons, could you pick up personal development messages?
Yes.
Kind of like Joel Osteen?
Mm-hmm.
Like, you know, he really, his message... Mike, you know, I know it's based from the Bible, and I know he's, you know, it's religious, but man, it's personal development 101.
It is.
I mean, every time.
Every time.
So, same thing?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And it's funny, because if you were to ask him, you know, John, where did you learn about leadership? How did that come about? How do you know so much? Everything he teaches is biblical. In fact, he has a leadership Bible, and in that Bible he goes through and talks about the different leaders in the Bible and what he gleaned from them. And so a lot of what he learned initially was from his faith-based background.
And look, let's face it, and I say this all the time, even in my keynotes, if anybody in the personal development, self-help world tells you that they created something new, run, don't look back.
No.
This goes back to antiquity. This goes back to the beginning of time.
It does.
And what happens is that's why it ties in with, where the Bible ties in with personal development, because it is everything, right? And it's interesting when people that want to debate that, a lot of times when you really break it down, they're taking things out of context, right? To try and make their point. But look, at the end of the day, I don't care what religion you are. I don't care what you believe in. Listen, if you put us under the right microscope, we are all just a mass of energy vibrating at a high rate of speed. And thoughts are things. Quantum physics tells us that. So, you know, at the end, so that's so cool. I didn't know. I had no idea he was a pastor.
Yeah.
That is really cool.
Well, and the interesting thing to me is trying to blend kind of what you were talking about, the two worlds of universal law and biblical truth.
Yes.
There is so much biblical truth that surrounds universal law. And yes. To me, I believe God made it all. He made those universal truths just as much as he made me sitting here. And so that's just my beliefs, and I've been able to tie those together in my studies.
Oh, no question. I mean, if you believe in God, you believe in the universe, whatever title you want to put on it, then you have to believe in both of those because they are, that's what, that dictates how we live,
right.
Whether we can identify it or not.
Right.
It's just, it is.
It's just opening your mind.
Right.
And opening your mind to possibilities. Now, what if
and not only that, but it's also, and I want your feedback on this,
sure.
It's also living. So mm-hmm. when you're an infant, you have no idea, or even a toddler, you have no idea, more of a toddler because they're walking, you have no idea about the law of gravity.
No.
But when you go to take that first step down those stairs and you tumble on your head,
right?
Life goes, oh, by the way, I forgot to mention, there's a thing called law of gravity, right?
Right.
So maybe, you know, you might have been like me where it took me a few times, but maybe it took you once, whatever that is. But eventually, somewhere along the line, you either broke your neck or you, you know, you learned that there's something called the law of gravity.
Right.
You know, so I think you're right. I think there's being open, right? Being taught certain things, but it also goes back to the real world. And that's where I think and where it gets interesting is it goes back to what you said about keeping an open mind. So when you're talking about breaking down and not truly understanding the law of gestation or the law of cause and effect, unless you actually start to consciously learn about that, you're going to keep missing it, right? And
right.
Then you're going to wonder why things aren't going right. And it's simply because life is a game, right? And you're not playing by the rules of the game.
Right.
So that's why you keep striking out. That's why you keep missing, right? There's a law of gestation.
There is.
And so anyway, I love that.
I get
a little passionate. So get,
I
get
know.
It.
No, I'm
get
with it, you get every it. Step.
So,
it's amazing. So back in those days,
okay.
John made the decision.
Mm-hmm.
That rather than, even though our church had grown unbelievably mm-hmm. with his leadership,
mm-hmm.
and we had a new spot, we were moving, we were in the process of relocating to accommodate a larger congregation, it was already considered a megachurch, even back then. He made the decision to leave ministry, and although it was still in his heart, and he's still a pastor today, he does still speak in churches, from time to time, he decided to move what he had already started, and I want to say it was Enjoy Ministries, because he also has a business called Equip, and those, I'm not going to tell you exactly what each of those do,
mm-hmm.
but his mission was to impact more people,
mm-hmm.
to help other churches develop the pastors, because as you may or may not know, pastors are kind of lonely in a way. Unless they have their own inner circle, which he preaches in his truths, they sometimes feel alone and not supported. Even though the congregation will support them,
they still feel on an island.
They need their peers.
They feel like they're on an island.
They do.
Yeah.
So he wanted to help that group, and he also wanted to help churches grow. And he knew that in order to do that, and to broaden his audience, if you will,
yeah.
to get the message out, to give these truths out,
mm-hmm.
to kind of develop what he's learned,
mm-hmm.
all that stuff. He moved to Atlanta, Georgia,
mm-hmm.
primarily because of the big airport there. He felt it could get him places that San Diego couldn't.
Which is part of the business plan.
It
yeah.
was. It was exactly that.
Love that.
Yeah,
yeah,
exactly. And so his main business, is the hub, is still there.
Mm-hmm.
So it was kind of hard seeing him go because we all loved him,
right.
and knew the food we were getting every single time he got up before us. It was amazing. My dad did some traveling with him because he always took men with him to circle him wherever he went, kind of almost as a hedge of protection.
Mm-hmm.
So my dad had the opportunity to travel with him a little bit. This was years ago. And so over time, he obviously impacted me in my 30s. And I used his principles and his teachings in my career and learned as much as I could. And I can't say I'm perfect, but I've evolved as well. From where I started to where I am now, you know, I had those inner beliefs, those limiting beliefs, if you will, of not being worthy, of
that tape not playing in your head, right?
Exactly.
Yes.
And because I had my own tapes, and I had to learn to overcome those, that's the thing I have the most passion for, is helping people overcome their limiting beliefs and discover them. Because so many people don't even know what they have.
They can't even identify them.
Yeah.
So if you can't identify them, right?
No.
How are you ever going to conquer them? I love that.
Yeah.
And that's what I want to talk about next is you know, you connected with John through the church, and then eventually to where you are now. Now you actually connected with him on the personal development, right? Self-help world.
Yes.
What an amazing transition for both of you. Really,
absolutely.
If you think about it. And I know you said you just retired from a career. What was that?
With Department of Corrections and Rehabilitation.
Okay.
I worked for the prison system here in the state of California for about 25 years.
What'd you do?
Everything. I was the chief bottle washer. I started out in an entry-level job.
Okay.
I can remember one of the first duties I had was to type with a typewriter fingerprint cards for the inmates coming in the system. And I remember we couldn't make mistakes. And it freaked me out because, to tell you the truth, I didn't even know really how to type properly.
Right.
You know, that whole...
They just threw you in there, right?
I know. And I loved the environment because it was exciting and new and different. But to tell you the truth, it can be a very negative environment.
Oh, yeah. Very depressing if you let it. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
In fact, it's funny, the first promotion I got, I left one prison to go to another, and all three of my bosses said, "Tell you what, if you stay, we'll each pay you out of our paycheck to keep you here."
And we don't go anywhere, we need you, right?
Yeah. They liked my upbeat attitude and
plus the work ethic, I'm sure, making their job much easier.
Right.
So, and we're gonna fast forward a little bit here.
Sure.
So, let's share with everyone where you're at today, what you're doing, what your passion is, how that ties in with John, and then where you see yourself going.
Yeah. Oh well, it's an exciting time in my life.
Awesome.
I joined the team last year.
Okay.
I knew about it it's been in existence about 6 years. And I knew about it in the inception, but I wasn't in a place in my life where I could jump in. Mm-hmm. I still wanted to have my pension.
It wasn't your time.
Right. Mentally or in a lot of ways.
Mm-hmm.
And so I had to wait till the right time, which was last year. I joined the team, but I had been kind of keeping my foot in the door. John has a program called Maximum Impact Mentoring, and I was a part of that for many years. And so that was a monthly call, monthly tape, monthly training, if you will. I participated with that, so I always had my finger in it. And a lot of people know about Minute with Maxwell. It comes on every day, and that is part of the marketing for the John Maxwell team.
Okay.
And he gives his, somebody will give him a word, and just out of the, like, it's not rehearsed, it's not anything. He just knows exactly what to say about that word. And it's amazing to me how he does it. But, it's a great thing. If you don't get it, sign up.
Right.
It's great.
And you'll be able to share all that once we jump off.
I would love to.
Yeah.
And then, so I joined last year, and I went through a very intensive coaching program. The way we do coaching is unique, I believe, I can't say it's completely unique to John Maxwell team, but a lot of people who put on a label of coach or life coach, we hear that a lot lately, they don't do coaching the way we do coaching. Our coaching is a very intuitive process. We listen really closely to our clients, and we draw out limiting beliefs. We draw out dreams and whys and those kinds of things and help them really focus and live intentionally, just like you were talking about. So I help people with that. And that's, I think, truly where my passion is. But because I've had an interesting story, I've lost a daughter. That was a really hard time in my life. but also a struggle for me, because for the first time in my life, I finally figured out a little bit about what my mom and my first husband suffered with. Because if you don't have a touch of depression after you lose a child, then there's something wrong with you. And so I went through a period of time of opening my eyes to things and understanding things, and I've been able to help other parents. I did some work for a while facilitating things like group grief share, and also I was involved with Compassionate Friends. And these are groups that help people deal with grief. And so I have a...
So this manifested from your daughter's death.
Yes.
Isn't that interesting? I mean, isn't that amazing? Like, how... You know, and but let's really keep it real, right?
Sure.
You always had that choice. Life always said you could have went down that road, or you could have went down the dark, dreary victim road. So so you know, and that's where you I make sure that you get that credit, right? Whether you want to take it or not, you need to take that credit, because again, life always gives us the choices. Mm-hmm. Which road do you want to take? And you could have taken the dark, lonely, dreary road.
Yeah.
And there's not, there's a lot of things that I don't know, but here's what I do know for sure, that you wouldn't be here. Right?
It's true.
And you just wouldn't, because you wouldn't be that person. Mm-hmm. And I'm not talking about just this show. I'm talking about where you're at in life. You wouldn't be here because you wouldn't be that person. And that's, I love that. And that's something that needs to be highlighted and understood when people are going through those, I always say struggle equals strength, right? And when you can make it through, you, it's not that you made it through, it's the person you became in order to make it through.
Right.
That's the transition, right? That
it is.
That rebirthing, if you will, especially when you're talking about something that tragic.
Right.
That's, I just had to, I had to circle that, put arrows towards it and highlight it, all right?
Okay.
because that touches and relates to everyone.
Yeah.
Whether they went through that same experience or not does not matter, right? We all have our own journey. So, thank you. Knuckle that up, girl. Love it.
Well, and I'll just say too, you know, early on, I didn't do grief really well.
You didn't know.
It threw me back.
But
I didn't know how to deal with it. I tried everything that you can think of to get through it. But what I do know is, had I not met John Maxwell before that, I might have gone down that dark road, because I might not have known what else to do.
And you know what? I completely understand that, because I got introduced to personal development 17, 18 years ago, and that helped me be able to sit here and say that the proudest thing in my life to this point, business or personal, is me and my ex-wife were together 17 years, married and together, and never used an attorney, split everything down the middle, and we're still really close. So,
well, that's funny you should say that.
But so I get that, right? Because personal development, self-help, is the epicenter.
Mm-hmm.
It's everything. It should be taught from day one. And
well,
I don't want to get on that rant.
No, but I love it, because I feel the same way.
Right.
I'm going through a separation right now.
Right.
My husband and I are best friends. Mm-hmm. We are still doing things together. We decided how to split things up. His ex-wife and I are very close. They maintained a great relationship for their girls. And when I came into the family, she and I immediately realized how much we had in common. And to this day, I so admire her. Mm-hmm. And we have a great connection that I didn't know how it was going to swing but I had an inkling that it might be all right. But I was willing to face whatever, because I knew what I needed to do.
Mm-hmm.
And so when I made the decision and we did part ways, it's just been a beautiful experience.
Mm-hmm.
And most people don't describe a beautiful experience.
No.
With moving on when you know you need to.
And also, let's take it even a step further, and this is from my experience, is most people can't even relate to that. So even when you do go through it, there's still a level of disbelief in people that even know you for years.
Right.
There's a level of disbelief that it can be that positive, can be that clean,
right.
And can be... kept so right. I don't even know what other word to use except so right. You know, my ex-wife actually wrote a testimonial on, it's on my website. There's times where it was so powerful to me that there's times that I've actually read that to myself when I feel in that funk, you know, because I'm like, you know, you forget some things and just reading that and how she perceived me, right? Again, that what that does is it takes me outside of that frame, right?
Yeah.
So I get to see the picture as she saw it. And it's interesting when you can look at that in that perception that way. So anyway, I get it, girl. I get it.
It's good.
Yeah,
stuff.
Isn't it? Mm-hmm. It's awesome. And this is why you have so much passion for this message, correct?
I do.
Yeah.
You know, I just think that it sounds kind of trite or whatever, but love really does prevail.
Mm.
Sure, we meet people that we might not be our people. We might not get their vibe. We might not do a lot of things. But the one thing I've always noticed is you get to know people and really hear their story, their struggles, if you will, their challenges, how they overcame them, or how they're trying to.
Mm.
It sounds like a weird thing, but you fall in love with them. Not like in that kind of love that, you know, like I'm, you know, in love with you, but you love them because they're each so unique. Their story is so unique.
Mm.
Everything about them is so unique, and you appreciate it. And you want to really embrace who they are.
Yeah, and see, for me, what's interesting that you went there is I just did a short video today on connecting with people. You know, there's a lot of sales information out there. There's a lot of ways, you know, how to close the deal, how to connect with people. And look, at the end of the day, it's really simple to me anyway, is when that other person feels that you understand them, it doesn't mean you agree with them, but is if you understand them, now the barriers start to come down. Now the connection starts to happen. That's how simple it is. People make it so much harder than it needs to be. And it's so simple. And I have to learn in simple ways because I'm a simple guy.
Me too. So
when I can find something simple, I leech right onto it. But honestly, that's what, you're so right. It's so about that. And also, what I love about this show for me personally is I'm just a curious person to begin with. So
that's
when I can hear, like, and I love to figure out how we tick as human beings. That's what I love about the mind.
Yeah.
So I love that you know, you came to the same conclusion that I did. We just had a different journey, but it brought us to the same results.
Mm-hmm.
That's what's so cool.
It
brought us to the same results. I love that.
I do too.
So, let's before we jump off, let's share with everyone what you're doing now, what you do, what you offer, and then what you have coming up in the near future.
Right.
Deal?
Deal. Well, I love doing coaching, so I try to make it manageable for people so that I can help them develop who they are. And I explain it like this, is if you've had some success, say your thermometer of success is stuck on 72, and it seems like no matter what you do, you can't get beyond 72, and you really want to be at 90, I help you get to 90 and beyond. And so that's the thing I think I have the most passion with. And the way I do that is either through one-to-one coaching. I also offer things virtually, like mastermind groups on John's books. 15 Invaluable Laws of Growth is wonderful. And when you study it with somebody who's been living it a long time and those even that haven't, everyone offers different insights and you grow from those insights. I think one of the things that I'm really looking forward to is happening in April. It's not what I do as a business per se, but it's definitely something I have passion for. Many of you may have heard of Nick Vujicic. He's the guy that was born without arms and legs, and he is the ambassador in the John Maxwell team, and he partners with us through our Youth Max program. The Youth Max is a message of self-development, leadership, feeling good about yourself no matter who you are, you know, what's happened in your life, all of those things, building self-esteem, building leaders for our future. And the last week in April, more things will be coming about it. He'll be doing videos for us, for the John Maxwell team. John will be doing videos for us. We're merging together for a whole week to teach this message everywhere the John Maxwell team is. And we are in 140 countries plus. We have people all over the world doing just what I do in our neighborhood and in other countries. So that's the thing that's in the near future for me. And then I am so excited. I want to join John's team. We have 20 presidents that want our team to come teach leadership in their country. Mm. So we've been to Paraguay, we've been to Guatemala, and the next one up, we don't know for sure. We could go back to one of those, or maybe Colombia, possibly even Panama. I really want that experience under my belt to teach leadership through an interpreter and make a difference in another country. It's just mind-boggling the opportunity we have. So here locally, I can do one-to-one coaching. I can teach in your business, your people. If you have a small business especially, I can come in and do teachings on John's principles on leadership and personal growth, of course. And those are the things that I have the most passion, because I know they work, and they work for me.
That's awesome. That's awesome. So, Marion, before we jump off, anybody else jump on? Comments, questions, or shout-outs?
Cindy, great show.
Awesome. Thank you, Cindy.
Yeah.
Then this is the person you need to reach out to, Gloria. She'll open some doors and connect you with the right people. And you
Absolutely.
Guys already know each other.
Yeah.
So that's awesome.
Yeah.
That's awesome. Anybody else, Marion?
Joey,
just I do his show on Monday nights, the Joey
nice.
Giggle Show. Joey, thank you so much for jumping on, pal.
And Colin Porter.
All right, Colin Porter, all the way from the UK. So we're bringing them everywhere. We're recruiting them from everywhere. Thank you, Colin. Appreciate it, big man.
Beautiful.
And then Crystal Sanford.
Okay, thank you so much. Thank you for taking the time, guys, sharing this, and getting the message out there, because at the end of the day, if you've listened to any of this today, it really maps to one thing. It maps to personal development. Self-help is the epicenter. And it's just a matter of paradigm shift. That's all it is. Life is perception. Life is perspective. How you look at things dictates your direction, your end result, and your result, your reality. So that's the real.
Perfect.
That's
yes.
the real. Yes. Anybody else, Marion?
Your girl Coco.
Chef Coco.
You're Coco. I was thinking it might be my Coco.
Oh, is it?
It's okay. Hi, Coco.
If it's Chef Coco, give us a thumbs up.
And then Tim Campbell says hi from Kona, Hawaii.
Hey, Big Tim. Thanks, pal. Hope everything's well with the family. I know you guys are spending some time with your family out there. And thank you so much for jumping on. And you can run, but you can't hide. We're going to get you on this show sooner or later.
Then we got one from Joe Lansbury. Thank you, Dave and Lori, for such a great wisdom and knowledge today.
Awesome, man. Thank you so much. And make sure you send that book, and I'll sign it for you, big man. Thank you. Anybody else, Mary? Okay, Megan, thank you.
And Arthur Cho.
Okay.
And Marty, and his last name is EAH. I don't know how you pronounce that.
Okay, Marty and Spicer, thank you so much for jumping on. Hope you guys got a lot of value from this. We're going to reshare this. Lori's going to be able to jump on, reconnect with you guys, share her our contacts. So if you guys are looking to get into coaching, this is the girl you want to talk to. If you want coaching, this is the girl you want to talk to. If you want to learn more about John Maxwell, everything he's done, everything that he has, and I will tell you that I've been around the president of the company, Paul Martinelli, back in 2007 in Florida with Bob Proctor.
Yeah.
And that's how he got introduced to personal development. He's an awesome guy. And for John to bring him on as the president, because he did so much for Bob Proctor's company, mm-hmm. what a great coordinator and leader himself, and awesome guy, awesome story himself.
Phenomenal. He took the John Maxwell team from starting out the first certification, there were 500 people, and now last summer there was 3,500 in 6 years. That's what
he's been with them 6 years.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
He started the team with John.
Oh, did he?
Mm-hmm. Through a guy named Scott Fates. It's a fabulous story.
Wow, that's awesome. I was wondering where Paul's been, but I didn't realize that's that's awesome. Anybody else, Marion? I can't see it, so it sounds right to me. Thank you so much, guys. Thank you so much for jumping on. We appreciate it. Now, Lori, we end the show the same way every time. See, I believe that life gives us choices, right? Like we talked about earlier.
It does.
And life asks us questions.
Sure.
And right now, life is asking you a question. Life is saying, Lori, if you had a choice to either purr like a kitten or roar like a lion, what would you do?
Oh, I would roar like a lion.
That a girl, I know that. So we're going to take this out Monster Motivator style. It's called the Monster Motivator Roar.
Okay.
Now, the sound is just as important as the face.
That's
the sound is just as important as the pose. And it goes like this, right?
Okay.
So on three, we're going to take it out with the Monster Motivator Roar. Ready? One, two, three. That a girl.